The cast iron tables are mounted from the side, so I'm drilling and tapping for 1/4-20 bolts. Luckily, cast iron drills very easily. On the infeed table, the bolts go through elongated slots so I can adjust the position. Through holes in the jointer sides allow me to tighten it down in place. On the outfeed side, I need to pad out the sides of the frame, and I've carefully planed these pieces down to adjust the side-to-side position and have a snug fit. Then I make 4 blocks with tapped holes for jack screws. I cut the blocks close to the edge of the hole so the edge of the table will sit on the screws. Once the table is adjusted close to its final position, I could transfer the mounting hole location. The ends are open at the top, so I can make the adjustments just by reaching in here. I can't see what I'm doing either. I just marked 3 depth settings that I think I want to use, and they all overlap with each other. So there isn't quite as much movement here as I was hoping for. I could probably get away with it by making this a lot pointier, but there's a lot of extra space out here that I'm not using, so I could extend this at the same time and make it pointier. I think that's going to work better. And here it is. But the glue wasn't even dry before I already came up with a better idea than all of this. So the problem is this knob sticks out a lot, and the reason for that is because I want to be able to twist it without this being in the way. So it's longer than this. But this knob is in basically the worst possible place. It's just like right when I'm standing here, that's where my knee wants to go. I made this all in line because that was the easiest way of thinking about it, but it doesn't have to be in line. So with this big triangular sort of piece, the pointer could be up here in a place that's much easier to get to and see. And so the release for the detents can be up here and the lock can be down here. I marked the locations for the detents in a thin piece of plywood, and then I used that as a template to make the cuts in a thicker piece. So this works great. I had to add this piece, which acts sort of as a spring to keep this pressed in here. Otherwise, it could just flop out and fall out of the notch and fall down. The supports for the fence are attached with pocket screws and notched to fit around the belt. I added a little tab at the top, which will prevent the supports from being able to slide down at all over time. I had to add thin strips along the edges to get the fence to lock down really securely. I shimmed the front to get it perfectly square to the table. And I used melamine for the face. I wish it could be taller, but it has to be below my table saw surface. This odd thing is for working out the shape of the guard. So this represents the cutter head. I've made marks every inch. And because I can't see them once this is in there, I've got this piece on top. Duplicates those marks where I can see them. So first I'm going to put this with a little bit of room here, and I'll make a mark at the zero point, and then I move this so that my first mark is about parallel to the second mark, and I make a second mark, and then I move it again so this is parallel, make another mark. Just keep working my way down. Doesn't have to be exact. And that is the curve the guard needs to be. So this is a similar geometry to what is on my 6-inch jointer. It works, but when it's all the way open, it ends up like this. And it looks smaller on camera, but from here to here is like 16 inches. It's just, there's like no way that I could run a thing and like get over there around this thing. So I moved the pivot point from here to here. So this is much better as far as getting around it. But I think I can do better than this. So what if this could just like fold in on itself? So there's a slot in here and a pin in this. There's also a pin on here that catches on the table. So this can fold in like that. Now it's still, when it's all the way open, it still comes out just as far as the other one did. But it's further away from where you're standing over here. So if you're just doing something short and you don't have to get over there, it's not in the way. Whereas before it was like this. I copied Matthias's solution for the return spring. But on mine, it's all self-contained and can be removed with just two screws.
Oh dear, it's heavier. So close. Alright, what could possibly go wrong?
It's been about 2 months since those first test cuts. I did have to tighten the drive belt and get the outfeed dialed in, but it's working great, and I couldn't be happier with the way the depth adjustment is working. As far as I'm concerned, every other jointer in the world is now obsolete. And I know some of you are going to say, but I never adjust the depth on my jointer, so I don't care. And that's the whole point. I didn't used to either, and now I do. I've also gotten the question, why build a jointer? And setting aside the opportunity to reinvent the way they work, a 12-inch jointer is expensive and heavy, and I have a small shop in the basement. If I could get one down here, it wouldn't fit. So that would leave a combination machine, and for a number of reasons, that doesn't work for me. A standalone jointer is, at the low end, $4,000. A combination machine at the low end is $3,000. To build this the way I did it is around $1,700. And I know some of you are going to say that's crazy for a homemade machine, but the cutter head alone is about $700. $300 for the motor and $300 for the tables. You're at $1,300, you know, just on the basics. So if you want that cutter head, this is the cheapest way to do it. Basically, you don't have to get the saw stop tables. And if you had a free motor, you could save money that way, but you'd be hard pressed to do it for less than $1,000. I'm sure I'm also going to get the question, are there plans? And the short answer to that is no. I use specialized parts for this. The bearing housings, the cutter head, and the pulley are all from a Grizzly joiner that isn't made anymore. And I don't know how many of those parts they have in their warehouse, but I'm sure it's not that many. So I wouldn't feel right selling plans for something when you're going to have to, you know, improvise something else. The joiners that they have now have square bearing housings instead of round ones. So like it's a totally different thing. And the bearings are different sizes from this. So it's a whole different thing. You know, I don't know what size the shaft is for the pulley. So I wouldn't feel right sending you down that path. And that's part of the reason why I included the sort of the frustration of finding parts and getting the parts to work together in the video. You know, if you're going to go down this road, you're going to end up having to solve similar problems to that. So be aware of what you're getting yourself into. But I will have a very basic SketchUp file and the parts list of what I bought. And you can go from there. Oh, not the best chair. Good joiner, not a good chair.